Good morning. Welcome to Grace United Methodist Church. My name is Jaron Fish. I'm the Director of Congregational Care here. We want to welcome you this morning and welcome those of you who are joining us online as well. Want to remind you that at the end of each row, or at the end of most rows, there is a brown folder, and in that folder is a guest card, as well as a attendance card for those of you who consider yourselves part of the family at Grace. And hey, just to let you know, we consider you a part of the family of Grace if you've been here more than twice. So we would love for you to fill out the white side for that one, or the green side if you're a first-time guest with us. And if you're filling out the green side, please at least put your email address so that I can correspond with you this week. And thank you for coming and joining us here at Grace. So on June 5th, it's Pentecost Sunday, and we're inviting everyone as we gather for worship to participate in wearing red for that service for Pentecost Sunday. And so June 5th, mark your calendar, make a little note, and wear your best Georgia Bulldog shirt. We have a special announcement from our Director of Music Ministries.
Good morning. I am the Director of Music Ministries, and my name is Corey Howell, for those of you that don't know me. If just in case you weren't here when I made this announcement last Sunday, next Sunday we are having a hymn sing, a congregational hymn sing, in lieu of other special music, because the choir will be done with their season. We haven't done this for a while, and as you may have noticed over the past several months, there are no hymnals in the pews. Therefore, we are taking requests ahead of time. So if you already made your hymn request, that's fine, but if not, go ahead and pass around these clipboards that are in every section. Pass them around. You can write your name, a hymn that you're interested in. I've been told, you know, Christmas hymns are hymns too. So we've got a couple front runners already. I'm almost 100% sure that we'll be doing hymns like How Great Thou Art and His Eyes on the Sparrow, because those are by far the front runners. But the other eight or so hymns could be, it's still neck and neck on the other choices. So don't forget, pass them around. Make sure everyone gets a chance to see this. If you got a chance to sign it last week and you just thought of another hymn that you really loved, go ahead and add it to the list. We don't have any sort of limit on voting. Just don't vote for the same hymn twice. That's not right. So if you're watching us at home, you can feel free to drop me an email and just tell me what your favorite hymn is too. I want to hear from you as well, because you will be participating. I hope you'll be singing at home as we sing together here in person. And with that, we will have music to prepare our hearts and minds for our worship of Almighty God. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Delaney Kwan, and I invite you to rise as you are able and join me in our spoken call to worship. We come this morning full of ourselves.
Our concerns, our plans, our opinions, our schedules.
In this moment, help us empty our minds of the relentless I and make space for you.
Enable us to put down our priorities, to set aside our assumptions and schemes.
Open up our hearts to recognize your love in action in our lives.
Reassure us your divine vision, and let us rest in your unending care.
Be with us, Lord, as we worship you.
Be with us, God, as we praise your holy name.
And we begin our sung praise with a hymn of unity. This is called In Unity We Lift Our Song. It's in the Faith We Sing, if you got one of those handy. If not, it'll be up on the screen. We're going to do the first three verses. This is the tune of A Mighty Fortress Is Our God.
Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is one true church. And universal, whose holy faith let us now declare.
We believe in God the Father, infinite in wisdom, power, and love, whose mercy is in all his works, and whose will is ever directed to his children's good. We believe in Jesus Christ, Son of God and Son of Man, the gift of the Father's unfailing grace, and ground of our hope, and the promise of our deliverance from sin and death. We believe in the Holy Spirit as the divine presence in our lives, whereby we are kept in perpetual remembrance of the truth of Christ and find strength and help in time of need. We believe that this faith should manifest itself in the service of love as set forth in the example of our blessed Lord, to the end of kingdom God upon the earth. Amen.
now, according to your comfort level, we invite you to share signs of the peace in Christ with your neighbor. Your neighbor may be someone you know well, or they may be someone you're meeting for the first time. As you greet them with the peace of Christ, remember Jesus' words, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you." Let us share Christ's peace together.
Reach my gospel to every stay standing. We're going to move around just a little bit, not like crazy people, but like calm church-going people. Does that sound good? Okay. So what we're going to do is, I have a couple would you rather questions for you, and you're going to have to come to this side or that side. Do not trample each other, okay? We're just going to walk calmly. Does that sound good? Emma, Gibby, Kanan, will you stand up? We're going to walk. Stand up, Natalie. Okay. So first I'll point to this side, and then I'll point to this side. For lunch this afternoon, would you rather have broccoli or pizza? Broccoli? Pizza. Broccoli. Broccoli or pizza? You guys are all pizza? You'd rather have broccoli? Are you putting cheese on it at least?
No.
No? Okay. All right. What's your question, Quinn? You want both? Yep. You like broccoli and pizza? Okay. Here's your next one. Would you rather have for dessert ice cream or nothing? Ice cream or nothing? Wow, I'm surprised. Ice cream or no dessert? Yeah, you guys are acting pretty healthy. Parents, is this true? Okay, next one. Would you rather be really good at math or really good at soccer? Math or soccer? So really intelligent or really good at sports? All right. That one's a hard one. You play soccer too?
Yeah.
That one's tricky. Would you rather be 7 feet tall or 3 feet tall for the rest of your life? 7 feet tall or 3 feet tall? Really tall or really short? Everyone's really tall but you. Sorry. We can look up at all of them. Okay. A few more. Would you rather Pastor Jeff have really, really fancy clothes and bling, or be really wise and smart? So really fancy clothes or wise and smart? Wise. There are a few of them who want you to have on like golden robes. Okay, let's take a look at this. If you had to drink out of this, and I only washed the outside and the inside was full of mud, or I washed the inside and the outside was a little sticky, which one would you rather drink out of? Clean inside or clean outside? Clean inside or clean outside? Good choice. Okay, you guys can all sit for 1 minute. Okay. So in the scripture this morning, we are hearing some church leaders, and they're kind of getting scolded. They're getting in trouble because they have not been following Jesus' teachings. They've been teaching all these crazy, silly rules, like you have to do this and you have to do that. But they're being told that they aren't quite living right. They're kind of like dressed up in all golden fancy robes, but they're not teaching what is right. So when you all said that you'd rather Pastor Jeff be wise instead of dressed really fancy, that's how Jesus tells us he wants us to live. He wants us to be humble and kind and follow his ways. He doesn't care what we look like or if we're really tall or if we're good at soccer, but he cares about who we are. If you were to drink this cup full of mud, would that be yucky? Yes, and that's kind of like us. If we look really nice on the outside, see how shiny and new, but we're full of yucky stuff on the inside, then are we really following God?
No.
Probably not. But even if we look a little disheveled because we rushed to church this morning, but we have clean hearts on the inside and we're trying to follow God closely, then we're doing what we're called to do as Christians. You guys agree with that? Yeah, okay. Next time we'll do some funny would you rathers. Will you guys pray with me? All right, dear God, thank you for today. Thank you for loving us and for sending your son to show us how much. Please help us remember to always follow you. and to not worry about worldly things. We love you, God. Amen. All right, you guys can line up by Miss Sarah.
We've reached that time in our service for the congregational care moment. Please remember these in your prayers this week. Please continue to lift up Rick Abaya, Richard Stanfield, Sharon Coughlin. Please add Bob and Rachel Griffiths to your prayer list, as well as Barb Ney, Frank Kane, who had a stroke this week and is recovering at home. The family of Eddie Greer, that's Charlie Greer's brother, who passed away on Wednesday. Kristen Fertugno, that's a friend of the Strezoffs, facing open heart surgery. Continue to lift her up. Cindy Cather, as well as Kurt Cather. Ricky Gleaves, Barbara Merringer, Suzanne Thompson, Annie Clem, Glenn Malone, Christine Fontaine, Mitch Warner, and Tara Curcio. That's Joe and Pat Rice's daughter-in-law. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we come before you this morning, thankful for the opportunity to be together, to gather under your name. We lift up to you these prayer concerns that are mentioned here, those who are facing illness, loneliness. May we be your hands and feet, vessels of your love. Lord, we know that there are many concerns on our hearts and our minds, those that have not been mentioned here. Maybe even those that we are shy to mention to others. We ask that you would be present. That our loved ones and those that we come in contact with will be aware of your presence, your love, and the hope. We raise our voices and lift our hearts in the prayer you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
This morning we are continuing our sermon series, The Sin of Certainty, and we're going to be reading from Matthew chapter 23. I do want to say this. If I did shorten my sermons, some of you would have shorter naps, and so you're welcome. All right, Matthew chapter 23, basically the whole chapter. Here we go. Then Jesus said to the crowds and to his disciples, "The teachers of religious law and the Pharisees are the official interpreters of the law of Moses. So practice and obey whatever they tell you, but don't follow their example, for they don't practice what they teach. They crush people with unbearable religious demands and never lift a finger to ease the burden. Everything they do is for show. On their arms, they wear extra wide prayer boxes with scripture verses inside, and they wear robes with extra long tassels. And they love to sit at the head table of banquets and in the seats of honor in the synagogues. They love to receive respectful greetings as they walk in the marketplaces and to be called rabbi. Don't let anyone call you rabbi, for you have only one teacher, and all of you are equal as brothers and sisters. And don't address anyone here on earth as father, for only God in heaven is your father. And don't let anyone call you teacher, for you have only one teacher, the Messiah. The greatest among you must be a servant. But those who exalt themselves will be humble, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. What sorrow awaits you teachers of religious law and you Pharisees, hypocrites, for you shut the door of the kingdom of heaven in people's faces. You won't go in yourselves, and you don't let others enter either. What sorrow awaits you teachers of religious law and you Pharisees, hypocrites, for you cross land and sea to make one convert, and then you turn that person into twice the child of hell you yourselves are. Blind guides, what sorrow awaits you, for you say that it means nothing to swear by God's temple, but that it is binding to swear by the gold in the temple. Blind fools, which is more important, the gold or the temple that makes the gold sacred? And you say that to swear by the altar is not binding, but to swear by the gifts of the altar is binding. How blind! For which is more important, the gift on the altar or the altar that makes the gift sacred? When you swear by the altar, you are swearing by it and by everything on it. And when you swear by the temple, you are swearing by it and by God who lives in it. And when you swear by heaven, you are swearing by the throne of God and by God who sits on the throne. What sorrow awaits you, teachers of religious law, and you Pharisees, hypocrites! For you are careful to tithe even the tiniest income from your herb gardens, but you ignore the most important aspects of the law, justice, mercy, and faith. You should tithe, yes, but do not neglect the most important things. Blind guides, you strain your water so you won't accidentally swallow a gnat, but you swallow a camel. What sorrow awaits you, teachers of religious law, and you Pharisees, hypocrites! For you are so careful to clean the outside of the cup and the dish, but inside you are filthy, full of greed and self-indulgence. You blind Pharisees, first wash the inside of the cup and the dish, and then the outside will become clean too. What sorrow awaits you, teachers of religious law, and you Pharisees, hypocrites! For you are like whitewashed tombs, beautiful on the outside, but filled on the inside with dead people's bones and all sorts of impurity. Outwardly, you look like righteous people, but inwardly, your hearts are filled with hypocrisy and lawlessness. What sorrow awaits you, teachers of religious law, and you Pharisees, hypocrites! For you build tombs for the prophets your ancestors killed, and you decorate the monuments of the godly people your ancestors destroyed. Then you say, if we had lived in the days of our ancestors, we would have never joined them in killing the prophets. But in saying that, you testify against yourselves that you are indeed the descendants of those who murdered the prophets. Go ahead and finish what your ancestors started. Snakes, sons of vipers, how will you escape the judgment of hell? Therefore, I am sending you prophets and wise men and teachers of religious law, but you will kill some by crucifixion, and you will flog others with whips in your synagogues, chasing them from city to city. As a result, you will be held responsible for the murder of all godly people of all time, for the murder of righteous Abel, to the murder of Zechariah, son of Berechiah, whom you killed in the temple between the sanctuary and the altar. I tell you the truth, this judgment will fall on this very generation. This is the word of God for the people of God. All right, let's pray. Good morning, Lord. We thank you for this opportunity that you've given us to be able to gather here and to worship you, to sing your praises, to enjoy each other's company, to laugh together, to pray together, to be blessed when those among us share their gifts like singing and playing instruments. And all this is worship of you and offered to you. And now, as part of our worship, as part of our time together, we turn our attention to your scriptures. We ask you might open our ears that we might hear. Lord, sometimes the hardest thing to hear is things that we've heard before. And so make these words of scripture ring new in our ears. Sometimes the hardest things to hear are when we think we already know. And so help us to turn to your scriptures eager, anticipating a fresh word from you. I pray this morning that you would hide me behind your cross and that your words would fill my mouth and that through all of this you would receive glory. Amen. All right, so last week we started this sermon series, The Sin of Certainty, and we looked at, we discussed our certainty of God. And probably a better way of thinking about that, and we talked about this too, isn't so much our certainty about God or whether or not there is a God. That's not the point. The certainty that we often fall victim of is the idol of God that we've created mentally. If you were here last week, hopefully you remember that. That what we do is we create this mental image of God in our minds, and then we believe and we defend wholeheartedly that that is the truth about God. And in the process, that becomes idolatry. And if we're not careful, you could even call that the idolatry of God, which is interesting. So this week, what I want to look at is the certainty we have about ourselves. So let me ask you a question. By show of hands, if you are perfect, put your hand up. Okay, good. Whew, all right. I was a little concerned about, yeah, put your hand down, Dewey. I know you well enough, Dewey, put your hand down. Okay, so let me ask you this. So we agree that nobody's perfect, including ourselves. Nobody's perfect. All right, here's the next question. Do you want to change? Do you want to change? All right, now how many of us are actively doing anything to change? Some, depending on what aspect, right? Okay, so like for example, I mentioned about a month ago, or actually it's been 3 weeks ago, Denise and I were going to start eating healthy. And we have, and so I'm pretty proud of that. I'm actually doing something. But I got to admit, the only like that doesn't mean that the only place that I'm not perfect was in my weight. Right? So there's other aspects of my life that I'm not perfect, and that and so I need to be thinking about myself holistically. And where am I not perfect? And should I be actively trying to change that? So what we're actually talking about here, right, is this the difference between what some philosophers call belief and unbelief. So we have these beliefs that we present to everyone, right? So for example, I'm not perfect. That is the belief that I present to everyone. But then deep down, if I don't do anything about it, then deep down my true belief might be that I actually am. Okay? So the belief that I present to everybody that I want you to believe about me is called unbelief. That is my unbelief. But deep down inside me, I have my true beliefs. Now, every now and then, my true beliefs, my beliefs accidentally show themselves. And I may not even notice it. Because here's the other thing. The tricky part about an unbelief is you actually believe it about yourself also. Are you tracking with me so far? Let me give you an example. I was recently having a conversation with a friend of mine, and I know my friend very well, and he prides himself on how he has grown up in a particular family where racism was prevalent, but now he is not racist,
right? He'll just tell you straight up, I'm so proud of my, like, he won't say proud because we're also very humble, right? But he's not racist anymore. And we were talking about the NFL draft, and he said something about all of those players sitting there with their black moms. Okay. I'm willing to bet my friend didn't even realize what he had said. But in that moment, that belief of racism that is still inside him comes out. But if you ask him, and I truly, he believes it wholeheartedly. And I will say this for my friend, he's aware of himself pretty well. And so if he had realized that, he would have been ashamed and he would have tried to do something, he would have tried to change. And there's an awareness that would have come with that, right? But his unbelief, the things that he presented is, I am not racist. But in that moment, that little glimpse, maybe there is still some in there. Do you see what I'm saying? Right? Unbelief is the holding of a belief that we don't really believe, a belief that hides the reality that what we really believe is generally not reflected in the image we have of ourselves. That's the definition of unbelief. Let me read it again. Unbelief is the holding of a belief that we don't really believe, a belief that hides the reality that what we really believe is generally not reflected in the image we have of ourselves. And I would also add the image that we then present. So the issue then is that our certainty is often actually based on our unbelief. Are you still tracking with me? The false beliefs that we have set up are often where our certainty resides. Let me give you an example in another place in the Bible. We're going to talk about this here for a second. This is in Matthew chapter 9, beginning in verse 20. So they brought the boy, but when the evil spirit saw Jesus, it threw the child into violent convulsions, and he fell to the ground, writhing and foaming at the mouth. How long has this been happening? Jesus asked the boy's father. He replied, since he was a little boy. The spirit often throws him into the fire or into water, trying to kill him. Have mercy on us and help us if you can. What do you mean, if I can? Jesus asked. Anything is possible if a person believes. The father instantly cries out, I do believe, but help me overcome my unbelief. The true belief of that person appears in the words, if you can. Now, what needs to be changed is the belief. The if you can needs to be wiped out. But the only way that you can wipe that out is if you first confront the unbelief and you begin to put a crack in the veneer. You begin to break down the image that we have created of ourselves in our minds that we then try to present to the world. Am I perfect? No, but I sure want everyone to think that I am. Or are you perfect? No, and I truly believe it because it shows you what a good Christian I am and how humble I am, but I don't do a darn thing to change because really deep down in my beliefs, I am already perfect just the way I am. Which is often more likely, especially for Christians, right? So let me say this. The unbelief is, yes, I am not perfect. I am a sinner, and I'm very humble, and I just completely throw myself on the grace and mercy of God. That's often our unbelief. The belief is, I'm perfect just the way I am, and if everyone else would be just like me, the world would be a whole better place. You get that? Now, do we understand what I'm saying? Okay, good. So let's take a closer look then at what this story is telling us, because I think this is extremely important for us. Right? It's tempting for us to think that Jesus is chastising these leaders because of their inner darkness. But this doesn't really make sense in relation to the wider trajectory of the Gospels. which Jesus seems to appear to be accepting people in their brokenness. Right? Think about all the people that Jesus meets with, and it seems like he accepts them in their brokenness. So what's the problem with the religious leaders, right? Let's contrast this condemnation with the parable of the tax collector for a moment, who acknowledges his darkness and is praised by Jesus. The Pharisees have not found a way of expressing their darkness. And so it festers in them, in their unconsciousness, as an unacknowledged reality. The problem isn't that there's darkness. The problem is it's not acknowledged. And so it begins to fester. It's only as we admit to our captivity to this unbelief that we've created that we can begin to confront what we truly believe in our hearts. As long as I truly believe that I'm perfect, there's no reason for me to change. Especially if I can continue to convince you that I'm humble. So while these religious teachers are not being honest about the truth of their beliefs, it would be wrong to think that Jesus is angry because they're somehow lying to others. It's much more likely that the religious leaders are actually lying first and foremost to themselves. Because we often believe our unbelief. It's hard for us to think of ourselves as broken, so we deny it, even though it's obviously true. The religious leaders Jesus is addressing would no doubt feel misunderstood and indignant about his accusations. They do. Because their ego, this image that they have of themselves, is not simply a cover to help them maintain a positive image in front of others. More fundamentally, it provides a way for them to maintain a positive image before themselves. They truly believe that they're all of that. And when you tell them they're not, it becomes a problem. We're all tempted to fall into the same trap as these religious teachers whom Jesus chastised. We want to hold to the image that we have of ourselves and our world because it is a fiction that gives us a sense of place, purpose, and perspective. Our various foundational beliefs about the world, God, and ourselves, they act like a shield that protects us from a full confrontation with what we actually believe. When I am certain, I have no reason to change. And therefore, my certainty becomes an obstacle to what in the Christian church we call sanctification. Because for me to truly experience sanctification, because I've done such a good job of fooling myself on who I am, it requires other people's eyes to help me see. Those moments when I say something and it reveals my true self. I have to have people around me that love me enough that are like, oh, that was interesting. Tell me more about that. I want to hear more about that. I don't want to hear any more about how humble you are. I want to hear more about that moment when you said how right you are, when how correct you are. I want to hear more about that. I have to have good friends that love me that are willing to call me on my garbage. Jesus was the other set of eyes for these Pharisees, and they crucified him for it. Think about this. This is just a silly, simple example. We have started having a different affirmation of faith every Sunday. Anybody notice that? How many of you hate it? Honestly, how many of you hate the fact that we do that, right? Here's the thing. It's because it's really easy for us to just continue to blah, 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 blah every Sunday. In fact, I did it this morning. Did you hear me? I believe in God the Father Almighty. Oops, that's not the one we're saying. See, and what happens is just by being forced to do things a little bit differently, we actually begin to wonder, do I actually believe, hopefully this is the point, do I actually believe the things that I'm saying? Or has it just become so rote for me that I can just say it, doesn't matter if I believe it or not. Now, having one of them, the Apostles' Creed, memorized is really good for those moments when we're doing a baptism and all of a sudden the screens freeze up. Remember that? I'm so glad we have it memorized. So there's nothing wrong with having like these things that are just like, it's memory for us and this is what we do and this is who we are. But we have to be willing to stop sometime and say, but wait a second, is that a belief or is that an unbelief? Is that a belief or is that an unbelief for me? Right, when we encounter a worldview different from our own, there are four common responses that we have to this. One is called consumption. And what that means is, okay, you're different than me. Your beliefs are different than me. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to convert you into my beliefs, and then you can become part of my group. That's consumption, right? So when we meet a different worldview, that's one of the things we want to do is, well, your worldview is different than mine. Mine's better. So I'm going to change yours, and then you can be part of my group. That's called consumption. Another one, the technical way of talking about it is called vomiting, but I changed it to rejection. Right? And that's where your worldview is different than my worldview, so we can't have anything to do with each other, and you can't have anything to do with my group. I'm going to reject you. And so now you're the outsider, and we're the insiders. And don't question our worldview. Don't challenge our worldview, because this is what we believe. Or maybe this is what we unbelieve. But it makes us really comfortable, and so we're going to stay right here. The third way is toleration. And what that means is, okay, your worldview is different. That's fine. You can still be part of our group. Just don't let anybody know. Keep quiet. Keep your head down. Every now and then we'll see it. We'll be like, isn't that cute? That's so cute. But just don't create problems for the group. And then the fourth way is called dialogue, and that means I'm going to enter into conversation with you. Now, I have to admit, the first time I came across this in a philosophy book I was reading not too long ago, I thought, oh, that's me. I'm dialogue. And I thought, so I felt really good about myself. I was like, oh, I'm always willing to enter into conversation with people, and I find it so interesting, right? And then the author went on and said, but here's the problem with that. In all four of those, we judge the outsider from our position. I was like, wait a second, bud, I was doing really well. Why was I doing well? Because I'm better than everybody else. I'm willing to enter into dialogue. What the author said is there's a different approach. And as I read about the different approach, I thought, you know what? This is actually the approach the disciples took to Jesus. Because think about Jesus, right? With those four things. All four of those things are present in the gospel stories. Some people completely, they like try to convert Jesus back to, listen, you're getting off camp. We need to convert you back to traditional Judaism. Okay, and so that happens. We also see complete rejection all the way to a cross. We see some toleration. And then we actually see some dialogue. But it's the disciples that actually choose the fifth way, which is placing themselves beneath the other in the sense of allowing their views to challenge and unsettle their own. When we hear something different, allowing ourselves to be challenged and unsettled. That's what the disciples did. Think about it. I mean, Jesus comes in and just flips their world completely upside down. And for some reason, they still follow him. I mean, listen, when he looks at them and tells them, like there's a story in the Gospels, you might be familiar with it, where he starts talking about this thing, and it's really hard teaching, and all of a sudden, like so many of them leave, and he looks at his disciples and says, are you going to leave too? And they're like, well, where else are we going to go? That means things are being really turned upside down. Where else are we going to go? what are we going to do? Everyone else has left me. What are you going to do? See, what happens here is that Christianity is about trusting in Jesus' worldview. The way Jesus looks at this world and the people in this world. Trusting in the things that he taught and that he did, and then having our lives turned upside down to reflect Jesus' worldview. My worldview today and Jesus' worldview today are not the same. If they were, I could have raised my hand when I asked the question if we were perfect. Christianity continues to decline in the United States. COVID, like, poured gas on the fire. Anybody disagree? Okay. But here's the thing. If we listen closely to those that are leaving, we begin to hear a cry, right? They believe that questioning leads to a deeper understanding. But their experience is that religion frowns on questioning. Because it believes, it presents itself as already having all the answers. And so when their questions arise, it leads them actually farther away rather than deeper into. And I can't help but wonder if with Christianity we're actually presenting our unbelief as the belief. I recently was visiting with a friend of mine. He's Jewish. And the only reason that matters is because he said something to me because of his Jewish faith that really made me think for a moment. He said this. He said, beliefs change, and beliefs not only change, but they should change. Your beliefs should change while your faith remains. So the problem is we think that faith and belief are the same thing. He pointed out all the differences in Judaism. And we get a glimpse of it in the Gospels. And those differences still exist today. And he says this, and I had to write it down. We can have different beliefs and the same faith. We can have different beliefs and still have the same faith. So what upsets us most about those who leave the faith? Because we get upset about it. What upsets us the most? Is it their lack of belief, or is it our fear of confronting our own unbelief? Is their rejecting of their religion? The problem is it starts to make me feel uncomfortable because it might force me to actually take a moment and think about myself. If having faith means that I have to hold on to certainty, when certainty is crumbling all around me, then my only option is to go to war, even if that means killing my own. Now, the Bible is full of people questioning what they believe. It's all through the Bible. They question their beliefs, their worldview. In fact, there's some authors that even question whether or not they believe in God anymore. These expressions of abandonment, they aren't godless moments that we see in our Bible. They relay the experiences of ancient men and women of faith, and they were kept in the Bible because those experiences were common. They were part of being an Israelite, and therefore they were valued. For us, they signal not only what can happen in the life of faith, but also what does happen, and maybe even what we should expect to happen. Amen.
At this time, I invite you to rise as you're able and join me in singing our next hymn. This is the first two verses of 'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus. It's number 462 in your hymnals. We'll sing the first two verses.
As a community of faith, take a moment to meditate on the ways we may give back to God, not just of our tithes and offerings, but also of our time and talents. Let us join together in this offertory prayer.
God of the mountains and valleys, of the dry places and oceans, your voice speaks to us across creation. The flowers and the trees sing of your majesty. Then the stars of the night speak of how much we still don't know. As we offer gifts to you and speak our words of gratitude, help us to hear your voice anew. Give us ears to hear, faith to believe, and determination to truly listen to how you would send us into a hurting world. In Christ we pray. Amen.
I invite you to join me in singing our offertory hymn, Just As I Am, the first three verses.
Thank you.
I invite you to hang out for a moment after the benediction and listen to the choir's response to the benediction. Brothers and sisters in Christ, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May he turn his face to shine upon you. And may we offer back to God trust rather than certainty. Amen.
May the road rise to meet you. May the wind blow at your head. May the sun shine warmly on your face. May the rain fall softly on your field. And until we meet again,
sort of A2.